Hello, wrestling fans, and welcome to this week's edition of Mid-South Wrestling Television Network. I'm your host, Boyd Pierce. A great, exciting card. You'll see Steve Dr. Death Williams as he battles Big King Kong Bundy. Also, popular Mr. Wrestling 2 against the Russian star Boris Zirkov. The new Mid-South Tag Team Champions are here, Hacksaw Dugan and Magnum T.A. The North American Heavyweight title holder, Hacksaw Butch Reed. It all adds up to a lot of action. Before we start, here's our guest commentator, Cowboy Bill Watts, with some interesting information. Bill?
Well, thank you, Boyd. And, of course, there has been some great action in the Mid-South area. Baton Rouge, July the 22nd, had the biggest gate ever in its history. We want to congratulate the people of Baton Rouge and promoter Jimmy Killshaw and his mother. July 19th, Little Rock, Arkansas, a great one. Morgan City, a little bit of town in Louisiana, had them hanging from the rafters. And, of course, Paul Bosch, the venerable promoter of Houston, July the 29th had a big one. So it seems like that Superdome just kicks everything off to a big, hot summer season. One thing about it, Junkyard Dog may have lost the North American title, but he hadn't lost the loyalty of millions of fans. And the kids of the San G Teen Club in New Orleans had voted him above Michael Sphinx and all the Saints and everybody else as the man they'd most like to have at their big event at the Rivergate July 23rd. Let's watch now as Jerome Johnson, the announcer, and Tex Stevens from Mayor Dutch Morrell's office made Junkyard Dog an honorary citizen of New Orleans. Joyce Stuhlman from the Governor Dave Treen's office made him a colonel in the governor's staff. I think it's a great honor, and Junkyard Dog really enjoyed himself. Let's look at some highlights of that.
Yeah, this is a story of famous dog. But the dog that takes his tail will be busy. We are happy dogs. Rhythmic dogs. Harmonic dogs. House dogs. Street dogs. Dogs of the world unite.
Here representing the city of New Orleans and the Honorable Mayor Dutch Morrell, we have going to present a special award to the Junkyard Dog, Mr. Tex Stevens from the mayor's office in New Orleans.
They call him the Junkyard Dog. Let me say this. Hold it, not now, I'll tell you when. He's good for business. I want to thank Mid-South and Jack Curtis and all those wonderful people to allow the Junkyard Dog to come down here. Junkyard Dog visits hospitals to see that the sick are inspired, the blind. He is a business enterprise, and he's just good for the city of New Orleans and the entire state of Louisiana. And I would like to make this presentation to a young man who has dignified himself in his professional specificity. Some people call it wrestling, but I call it wrestling. I would like to introduce to some and present to many, yours for the asking, our indoctrinated citizen. We call him the Junkyard Dog. Now you can lay it on him. All right. Dog, let me say this. Those young people out there, they pay the taxes to make this presentation available. Isn't it beautiful? On behalf of Mayor Morrell, be it known that the mayor of New Orleans has conferred the title of honorary citizen upon the original Junkyard Dog, signed by all of the members of the city council, and the Honorable Ernest Nathan Dutch Morrell, mayor of the city of New Orleans. So we don't want you to go back home. We want you to stay here with us because we're very proud of you. You have added another dimension of life. You've inspired a spiritual indoctrination in the minds of young people. You have also helped to broaden youthful horizons. And also, you have built an inner structure, or shall we say, an infrastructure of progress, not only for yourself, but for the entire city of New Orleans and those wonderful young people out there. Let's lay it on them. One more time. One more time.
From the office of the Honorable Governor of State of Louisiana, Governor David C. Treen, we have Ms. Joyce Stuhlman to present the award and presentation from the State of Louisiana. Ms. Stuhlman?
Again, I'm happy to be sent here tonight by the Governor to present Junkyard Dog a merit, an award of merit. The governor has proclaimed Junkyard Dog colonel on his staff. When you get awards like this, is because you're doing so many good things. And let's give him a big hand.
It's a great honor to be here, and I'd like to thank Jack Curtis and Lena and the rest of them for getting me here, and I'd like to give thanks to the Lord, my wife and my kid for making it possible for me to be able to come in to talk to you people. I know maybe I can get a point through just to one, or maybe five or six, but I grew up just like everybody else with nothing. I grew up hard back down in South North Carolina, but I fought and I'm still fighting, trying to better myself.
I enjoyed watching that, and I know you folks at home did too. And I'll tell you somebody else who enjoyed it and appreciated it. That's the Junkyard Dog, a tribute to a fine, outstanding athlete and a great wrestler. We'll be back with more exciting things to come here when action resumes on Mid-South Wrestling Television Network.
July the 24th in Tulsa, Oklahoma at the Fairgrounds Arena was excitement galore, pandemonium. The Mid-South Tag Team titles were won by Magnum T.A. and Hacksaw Dugan. Of course, Ted DiBiase is protesting it. He tried every move he could. He had Olympia not show up. He tried to have Bundy manage him. A lot of excitement, a lot of confusion. But one thing is for sure, Magnum T.A. and Hacksaw Dugan are the champions, and Reese Bowden interviewed him earlier.
It's my pleasure to offer my personal congratulations to Hacksaw Dugan and Magnum T.A. because on July 24th in Tulsa, Oklahoma, these two men won the Mid-South Tag Team Championships. And I'm sure that the fans would all like to know, what are your goals for from now on for the rest of the year?
Well, you know, getting these belts was the greatest achievement I've had in my athletic career. And I know Jim and I are very proud of these belts more than anything I've ever done before. And I know we're going to defend these belts just like they were the most important things in the world to us. And I don't think it's going to be just any little team that's going to come up and give us a challenge that it's going to take these belts away from us.
Well, certainly the date won't go down as a date in infamy, but it's an important date for me and T.A., a man that I didn't know could get down and get dirty, but to my surprise, to my happy surprise, I'm glad he did. So we went out and we took these tag team titles with the support and the help of the people. So I was going to go lay up a cigar, but I quit smoking. But there's some reason I want to get that through. I want to get something straight right here and now. First off, the first thing Hacksaw Dugan wants to do is run Ted DiBiase clear out of Mid-South. I'm not talking about out of town, Reese. Things have gone on long enough. DiBiase, pack your bags, because I want to run you out of town. Not out of town, out of Mid-South. And Akbar, I want you just one time, one-on-one, right here on TV, and it'll be a Christmas present. Come early.
An exciting team. They're ready for action. Let's go to Reese Bowden now in the ring to announce this next bout.
This is a non-title tag team event for one fall with a 10-minute time limit. In the red corner at 255 pounds from Memphis, Tennessee, Larry Hare. And his partner, also from Memphis, Tennessee, at 250 pounds, Bill Rose. And in the blue corner, the Mid-South Tag Team Champions at 280 pounds from New York City, Hacksaw Dugan. And his partner at 240 pounds from Virginia Beach, Virginia, Magnum T.A.
Tag team action now. The two men in the far corner dressed in black, Larry Hare and Bill Rose, against the new Mid-South Tag Team Champions, Hacksaw Dugan and Magnum T.A. Bill?
And you heard Dugan in his interview say what his goals for 83 are, to get the big cheese, Ted DiBiase, clear out of Mid-South, and to be able to get his hands on one-on-one on Skandar Akbar right here on TV. And of course, I'm sure Grizzly Smith would love to get that too, and all the fans at home. Dugan disdainfully turned his back on his opponent, and the guy laid the forearm to him. Dugan's spinning on a lot of air out there. Dugan introduced him to the turnbuckle. Dugan bailed him across the ring. Tags out to Bill Rose. Guys from Tennessee, I've not seen them wrestle before, but I know Hacksaw Dugan is double tough and Magnum TA. You know, a lot of people want Akbar in the ring. They got to remember he was a former North American champion and one of the most powerful men. He had a unique style of lifting the heavy iron on the bench press. The only guy I ever saw that would take 400 pounds, sit up, clean it, lay back with it, do 10 reps, sit back up with it, and set it back down. It was an unusual thing. Didn't take it off the rack. And you also know that with his pocketbook, he can hire a lot of things done. Dugan disgusted with the competition he's got there. He dumped them both out of the ring and decides to let Magnum TA take it. Hip toss. Body slam. TA, quick youngster. Had a tremendous bout here last week for the North American title against Hacksaw Butch Reed. Just a little bit outgunned. He says that's the way you learn. He said he'd never had anything easy in life yet. Whoa, lost his balance there. That's what happens when you try those fancy moves, and sometimes they're crowd pleasing, but you can get yourself in a lot of trouble too. Backbreaker. Headlock. Coming up next, a tremendous challenge match. Steve Dr. What Death Williams against King Kong Bundy. Trip from the outside there. It tripped Magnum. And going for the elbow. Magnum looks really disgusted. Magnum firing away. Other man starting in, and Dugan's starting to come for his partner to help him. Doesn't look like Magnum really needs any help with these two. I think right here you get a tremendous picture that's worth a thousand words of a couple of athletes and a couple of guys that are dreaming about being athletes. You don't see any signs on these two, this hair and this rose, of ever being in a gymnasium. You certainly see no coordination. There's a belly-to-belly suit play. And Dugan meets him with a spear. These tag champions steamrolled him.
Rick Ferrara counts the 1, 2, 3. The victors, the new Mid-South Tag Team Champions, Hacksaw Dugan and Magnum TA. We'll have more action after this word from Mid-South Wrestling.
This event is for one fall with a 10-minute time limit. In the red corner at 265 pounds from Russia, Boris Zirkov. And in the blue corner at 236 pounds from Atlanta, Georgia, the national heavyweight champion, Mr. Wrestling 2.
Russian Boris Zirkov against the one of the all-time favorites, Mr. Wrestling 2, Johnny Martinez. Your referee calls them together, calls for the bell. And Bill Watts.
Mr. Wrestling 2, the venerable legend. A man who is a tough customer. Loves competition. Competes because he wants to. He's been a main event, a class caliber main eventer. For many years, all over the country, he's starred. A proud man. A tough man, asks no quarter and gives none. Boris Zirkov. Big, powerful Russian, trying to make his mark here on Mid-South. And that's a tough one to be against. As I say, coming up next, we got Steve Dr. Death Williams and King Kong Bundy in a special challenge. Bundy claims that last week in the tag match, first of all, his shoulders weren't down. And upon reviewing the film, we had to agree with him. His shoulders definitely were not down. They weren't anywhere near down. You could have drove a Mack truck under them. Plus, also, what came to light was that Dr. Death was not the legal man in the ring. He wasn't even the legal man in the ring. Johnny Rich had been tagged into the ring. Now again, as is Mid-South policy, a videotape replay does not cause a reversal of a decision. Same as the National Football League or any other major sporting event. You can't change it just because the official made a bad judgment. That's part of the sport. You know, I get letters all the time from people saying, why don't you put two referees in there or get a different referee? Well, let me tell you, that's almost a part of it. That's just like a part of the human chess that makes up this king of sports, is that people trying to get these referees out of position and take advantage of the situation. I'm sure if you wanted to, you could just put every match in a cage and no referee. But again, that's just not the way the contracts are signed, and it's up to these guys to try to maneuver their opponent into what's the best advantage for themselves. And wrestling, too, just shows you what's the best advantage for himself when he tees off of that knee lift. Anyway, Bundy has challenged Dr. Death Steve Williams. They've had a lot of verbiage between each other. A lot of insults have been hurled by Bundy. He wants him one-on-one, and we'll get a chance to see that. Another man coming up later, the missing link, and I don't know who named him or what. There's not a lot known about him. Certainly his skills show that he has some intelligence and has been in a regimentated type thing because he's learned a lot of great wrestling maneuvers, but then at times he certainly doesn't seem to be coherent in his thoughts or his actions. The North American champion Hacksaw Butch Reed will be up later. Armbar by two. And Zirkov, oh, good move by two. Drop toe hold, reversal, comes into the leg. That shows you the skills of this man. Mr. Wrestling, too. He doesn't ever complain. He just goes out and gives it 150%. And Boris Zirkov's getting covered up right there. There he's got the leg tied up into the half Nelson. It's a pretty punishing ride there. Now he rolls him over in the back, predicament. Zirkov up two into the front face lock. Now Zirkov showing some of the tactics that he's more known for, more the roughhouse type.
Wrestling two, bring him out of that corner. As a lot of opponents try, there's no way to get away from a man, the veteran, the great wrestler, wrestling two. You can't hide inside that squared circle, and he'll bring you out in the center every time. Johnny Martinez checking you saw to see that it's legal and not a chokehold. Fine young referees we have on Mid-South Wrestling, and Johnny Martinez, Joel Armstrong. There he is once again leaning under. But the big, powerful Russian pushes him into the far turn point. And there he uses his shoulder as a battering ram. Mr. Wrestling, too, three times. Takes it to the midsection.
That's right, forearm smashes over the lung area on the back. They're very devastating, take a lot of the wind out of your sails. And you can't go without that fuel. Two reaching up, trying to get a flying mare. That slick head's kind of hard to get a hold of, especially when it's sweating. Reverse chin lock by Zirkov. Martinez checking to be sure it's not across the windpipe. Also have Alfred Neely tonight refereeing and Rick Ferrara. A couple of the veterans. I was noticing earlier some of the guys, John May and some of the guys from Hope, Arkansas, they're up here bringing a bunch of watermelon up to some of the guys to celebrate the Watermelon Festival in Hope, Arkansas. That'll be right in full swing. They said that the big ones have been a little late this year due to all the rain we had earlier. Oh, two missed it. Two missed that knee lift. Zirkov trying to capitalize. Tell you, instead of getting up there and posing, if you're going to get up and jump off on somebody, you better get yourself in gear. They're not going to be there forever. Especially an old possum like two that's going to let you think you got him in a lot of trouble and then fire up. He's going to get it all back together. You don't count wrestling two down until you've heard the referee count three and the bell ring. And two just takes his head off.
One, two, three with a knee. A victory for Mr. Wrestling Two. The big battle coming up, Oklahoma Stampeders, Steve Dr. Death Williams against the Atlantic City Avalanche of King Kong Bundy, right after this message.
Well, everybody likes to see the super heavyweights hook them up. The Oklahoma Stampede against the Atlantic City Avalanche, the master of the five count. They were in a tag bout last week. Dr. Death Steve Williams surprised everybody in getting a fast count on King Kong Bundy, and little did we know, it was truly a fast count, and Dr. Death wasn't even the legal man in the ring. That doesn't take away. It still goes as a victory for Dr. Death and Johnny Rich, but Bundy's upset, had some words to say about it. Let's watch that now.
Ladies and gentlemen, King Kong Bundy.
I want everybody to see it, Reese Benton. I want everybody to see the most scandalous act in professional wrestling. The idea of Steve, Dr. Dummy Williams, counting my shoulders down for a three count is a farce, it's a joke. And now he's running around with his chest puffed out, telling everybody he beat King Kong Bundy. These jackals at Mid-South, they couldn't find anybody to beat me, so they had to rob me and they had to cheat me. I want everybody to see it right now and see exactly what happened and see how you could drive a freight train under my shoulders as a referee counted to three.
They measure each other. Tie up, collar and elbow. Hey, they're both pretty cautious. They're both respecting that size and strength. One thing, you can never forget that mask. Doc found out once against Mitch Shelton when he went on under him at Gallagher Hall. And by gosh, if you get that. Oh! Boy, Bundy might have got a broken nose out of that one. Doc is firing away. Tag is made, DiBiase in. Doc is hammering DiBiase too. Johnny Rich is taking a piece of Bundy. Johnny Rich wanted some of that action. I don't know, Johnny. That Bundy, oh, they doubled up on him. Whoa, look at, Doc got him in sort of a stampede. Got a three. Doc got a freak out, Dr. Death and Johnny Rich.
You could see it right there. You could have driven a freight train under my shoulders. And Williams, you weren't even the legal man in the ring. Well, let me tell you something. Like I said, these jackals, that's all they are, is jackals at Mid-South. They won't reverse this decision when they see that I'm right. They won't reverse it. So I'm going to reverse it today. I'm going to take you, Williams, and I'm going to give you the avalanche. No phony stampede. And I'm going to give you the five count, and I'm going to have you count it out right in the middle of the ring. And you can go back to the farm in Oklahoma and tell everybody you took a beating at the hands of King Kong Bundy. I'm not going to be cheated, and I'm not going to be robbed. I've got too much money.
Well, you heard from King Kong Bundy, and what a thing about professional wrestling is you can always settle it man to man. Let's go to Reese Bowden in the ring for the introduction.
And this event is for one fall with a 10-minute time limit. In the red corner at 420 pounds from Atlantic City, New Jersey, King Kong Bundy. In the blue corner at 295 pounds from Lakewood, Colorado, Dr. Death, Steve Williams.
And it is one-on-one, man-to-man, Steve, Dr. Death Williams and King Kong Bundy as Alfred Neely calls for the bell and they're at it, Bill.
Well, they hooked up like two water buffalo. I guarantee you there's no love lost between these guys. A lot of accusations. Bundy said Dr. Death was a disgrace to the New Jersey Generals of the USFL, and Doc said he went down on the boardwalk and the things he heard about King Kong Bundy were things that made him ashamed of himself to even be in the same ring or the same building with the man. He said the guy was a bully on the playground and did a few other things. So they've really been talking it up and they're ready. The Oklahoma Stampede versus the Atlantic City Avalanche, 420 pounds of mass against 295 pounds of brawn. The knee in there, the experience factor on Bundy's side. Doc is still a little bit young with the professional rules. Went in for the single leg, took Bundy down. He got Bundy down, but that's a mistake, I think, with Doc trying to shoot in under that weight. He can get trapped. Referee Alfred Neely calls for the break. Man's in the ropes. These guys are overeager for each other. Doc, like I say, it's pretty hard to make the transition because you've been restrained by rules and regulations your whole career. Now all of a sudden you're in a sport where it seems like the rules and regulations are made to be broken. But he snatched that single leg again. Big Bundy, for all that mass, doesn't get too far forward. He doesn't have that weight leaning on you. Apparently Doc has found a home on getting that snatched single. He's punishing Bundy's knee with that. Crowd hollering, break it off. I tell you, you'd have a leg this, the size of most people there.
Well, like you said, Bill, there's definitely no love lost between these two contestants. The battle of the super heavyweights, if there ever was one here on Mid-South.
Now Doc is telling, come on, let's get it on. Now Bundy, woo. Now he shows you the difference in the amateur and the pro, where the big guys are just gonna start trying to bear down, and he's snapping those forearms into Doc, but Doc's no stranger from forearm. He was a starting guard at the University of Oklahoma team. Coach Barry Switzer fast to admit that on one-on-one blocking, he's one of the most powerful men that's ever been at the University of Oklahoma. Doc going for the, oh! Doc got out of the way, Bundy got out of the way, and Doc liked to almost, I thought he almost bent the ring post, which you know they're not gonna bend. That's drill collars. And Bundy quick to take advantage of it. Well, Doc's gotten out of the way. Bundy's got him up in the avalanche. Wow, 420 on him. There's Neely going, one, two, three. Wait a minute, Bundy pulling him down for the five count. It doesn't count with Bundy unless he gets fired.
He's out.
Doc got out. Doc got out. That's the first man I've ever seen that's got out from under Bundy, and Bundy's hot. Neely said, no, sir, you didn't get a five count. You know, it doesn't count with Bundy unless it's a five count. That's in all his contracts. Doc's can feel the pain of that 420 dropping on him. He did the wise thing. He got out to reconnoiter a little bit.
Bill, the timekeeping hammer was in the air at the four count coming down, but he did not make it five.
I thought Doc had just gotten stuck real good. Neely counting him into the ring. There's Doc trying to get in the ring, and Bundy attacking him. Bundy reaching down to slam him in. He slammed him, Doc held him, Doc's got him down, two. Doc almost had him. Doc almost had him, Bundy kicked out. I've got to admit, Boyd, I'm partisan. I like Doc. They're going toe-to-toe, these big behemoths, smashing each other with forearm smashes, clubbing each other. Doc firing, he's backing Bundy up. Doc's picked him up. Doc's got him for the stampede. Doc's standing him. There's Zirkov. Zirkov going to get him. Doc's got Zirkov. He slammed him. The Doc is on the stroll out there. The referee called for the disqualification, but Doc is showing what he's made of in the football field. Bundy's got Doc now. Bundy's going for the pile driver. It's been a disqualification. Bundy wants the energy. Doc got out of the pile driver. Look at Doc. He got out of the pile driver. Bundy was trying to injure him. He knew the match was over. It's a disqualification for outside interference. Look at these fans. They're standing up. It's out of control down here. The match is over, but Doc is really planting them with those tackles. Zirkov and Bundy. Zirkov and Bundy are on the run. Zirkov and Bundy are on the run.
Steve, Dr. Death Williams cleared the ring. You saw outside interference of Boris Zirkov resulted in a disqualification. There's the hand raise of Dr. Death Williams. We'll be back as action continues after this important message.
This event is for one fall with a 10-minute time limit. In the red corner at 251 pounds, the missing link. And in the blue corner at 275 pounds from Bandera, Texas, Bill Rathke.
Rick Pereira called for the bell.
It's a good thing. That's a disturbed man. Ooh, a tremendous chop into the kidney area by the missing link, or whatever you want to call him, into Bill Rathke. We don't know who's booked this man here. Grizzly Smith made the arrangement contractually by the mail and back to a post office box. Like I say, the guy at times shows that he has been a very great athlete with a lot of tremendous wrestling ability. And then the other times he looks like he just loses a little bit of the flow and goes off kind of into a whirl of his own. Certainly a muscled up man, and looks like he's in tremendous condition. Bill Rathke can't say the same. Missing link is really punishing that kidney area, chopping that kidney area. He's never let Rathke even get out of the starting blocks. He's very methodical in his attacks, certainly, Boyd.
Well, Bill, at the start, we had the burly Bill Rathke against the unknown quantity of the missing link, but things have developed where it's all missing link.
Well, I guarantee you, it often shows you right there that just being heavy is not going to get it for you if you don't have something to go with it. And of course, the crowd's still buzzing over the battle between Dr. Death Steve Williams and King Kong Bundy. They went at each other like two rogue elephants. The missing link attacking that kidney area, powering into that kidney area. Driving the elbows, knees. Well, Rathke just never got out of the starting box. Missing link into what I used to call a camel clutch. I don't really know a word for it. Rathke submitted. He gave up.
Gave it up, and the missing link makes his initial appearance, a successful one here on Mid-South. We'll be back as action continues after this word.
This is a non-title event for one fall with a 10-minute time limit. In the red corner at 260 pounds from Kansas City, Missouri, the North American heavyweight champion, Hacksaw Butch Reed. And in the blue corner at 240 pounds from San Antonio, Texas, Ken Johnson.
Ken Johnson in the red trunks against the North American heavyweight title holder, Hacksaw, I'm my own man, Butch Reed. Johnny Martinez, ready for the action, starts the count to bring him to the center of the ring and calls for the bell.
Ken Johnson almost caught him napping. He was going in for an ankle pickup there. Hacksaw Reed, the North American champion. And every dream he ever wanted has come true. And in that confrontation, that showdown between him and the Junkyard Dog, a 2 out of 3 fall match in the Superdome in New Orleans, Louisiana on the 16th of July, Hacksaw Butch Reed became the North American champion. A lot of people say a tainted victory, but he said the Dog tried to destroy him completely, lost his cool, went out as he has to go out. He says the Dog has to go out hard and fast and get it over quick because he hadn't got the endurance anymore. That Reed's a fourth quarter man. He can take him to the limit. Single leg by Ken Johnson. Said the Dog lost his cool and tried to beat him to death, and some people that didn't like the Dog paid him back, but he said when it came down to the money fall, the third fall, he won it fair and square. I let you folks be the judge. I can't take anything away from that athletic ability. When a man that size can drop kick and move like he does, he's agile, he's fluid, he is in shape. He's a power lifter in college, an All-American football player, played for the Kansas City Chiefs as a linebacker. He's got the credentials. You know, he's hungry. He's hungry for fame and fortune. I think more than that fame. I heard him saying the other day that he was talking about Hacksaw Dugan. He says, before I'm through with Hacksaw Dugan, he's going to know who his master is, and he's going to call me sir. And I've never heard such explosive problems right there. You know, I tried to make kind of a low profile when I was a North American champion because you attract enough action anyway that I didn't want to be stirring up anybody that wasn't already stirred up. You're going to be right in the center of things, Butch Reed. You're going to get more. Whoa, look how he held that man up there. I'm telling you, the athletic ability's there. The power's there.
And he used that power, Bill. It resulted in another victory to his long skein to Hacksaw Butch Reed, the North American heavyweight champion. Tag team action coming up, and we'll be right back after this important word.
It's tag team action now for one fall or remaining television time. In the red corner at 228 pounds from Los Angeles, California, Rip Rogers. And his partner at 233 pounds from Huntsville, Alabama, Doug Vines. In the blue corner at 250 pounds from Topeka, Kansas, Art Cruz. And his partner at 222 pounds from Knoxville, Tennessee, Tim Horner.
Rip Rogers always shedding his colorful robe as his partner Doug Vines in the ring. They'll be taking on the popper duo of Tim Horner in the green and his partner Art Cruz on the outside.
Well, I'll guarantee you'll see some movement here. There's some guys out there in the ring right now that won't let any grass grow under their feet. Tim Horner's a buzzsaw. The only thing I know you can do to Tim Horner is try to stop him before he gets out of the blocks, because he is at a 100-yard sprint all the time. Art Cruz, a tough kid. These kids get to Mid-South, they get a taste of the big time. They get the major league wrestling where they're making the good dollar. They get in that gymnasium, they want to hang on to it. They want to be here a while. They want to impress somebody. And you can see they go out and give it their all. Doug Vines, a newcomer. I've watched Rip Rogers since he's come here. The man's bulking up. He's putting on little meat on there. He's a powerful guy. When I was floored by Rip Rogers and took a little notice of him when he walked out here one day, Boyd, as you and I are getting ready to commentate a match, and he slapped Hacksaw Dugan. And let me tell you, I think I was in shock, and Dugan was too, because that's like walking up and slapping a grizzly bear. Oh, Horner into a fireman's carry. Good move by Tim Horner. He blocked both those shots and fireman's carried him. That's what I like to see, is when a wrestler with that good background counters that street fighting technique with a tremendous wrestling move, because I'll guarantee you, I don't care how big a bully you are, it's hard to throw those fists when you're on your back. Art Cruz. One faller, television time remaining. Next week, Boyd Pierce, we're going to have Tommy Wildfire Rich against Kamala, the Ugandan warrior. General Skandar Akbar will be making his own personal comments about that match. Mr. Wrestling 2 against Wild Bill Irwin. And Wrestling 2 will make his comments. And Hacksaw Butch Reed says he wants to set the record straight that he heard Mid-South's comments about his victory in the Superdome over the Dog. He wants to make his own. So there's going to be a lot of great bouts next week.
Action hot and heavy here as Doug Vines comes in, throws Tim Horner face first into the turnbuckle on the far side, comes back with that slam.
Trying to get a win here. There's 2 minutes television time remaining. These kids will all be out there really ginning to get that victory. They got to put somebody's shoulders to the mat if they can. A bunch of youngsters that generally on those preliminary bouts, and they're wanting to get that big time, just like Hacksaw Butch Reed did. He said, I'm coming in here, and I studied the dog and watched him, and I decided that there was a crack in his armor, that he'd gotten too big time, too many public appearances, going up and down the highway in his Mercedes and not in the gym enough. And Reed thinks he has taken it all from the dog. But you know, I've been at a few of the arenas, Boyd, as have you, and I've noticed the dog in there sweating before the matches, and he's got the push-up blocks out, and he's hitting the heavy iron. 301 pounds now, and he looks like he's really getting it geared together. And I know that Junkyard Dog, if you're going to put him away, you're going to have a battle of the century. I think it's credible, too, that he doesn't forget it. The people, the fans that have made him the box office hero that he is. And when he has a chance, he goes to these places and makes his appearances. 1 minute left. Good move. We got him. Almost had him. Horner almost had Rip Rogers. Rogers hanging onto that leg, made the tag. Vines in. Less than a minute of television time remaining, Boyd. Next week, Tommy Rich and Kamala, the Ugandan warrior. Oh, what a forearm with Art Cruz. Did he tee off, Boyd? How much time left?
About gone, Bill. We'll stay with it right up to the
Art
end.
Art Cruz is really in. Looks like we're going to have a victory here. Looks like he's got him.
Time is running out, so until next week, Boyd Pierce for Bill Watts saying goodbye, everybody, from Mid-South Wrestling Television Network. Hello, wrestling fans, and welcome to another week of Mid-South Wrestling Television. I'm your host, Boyd Pierce. I hope you'll stay with us all the way. We have a lot of exciting action to show you. Hacksaw Butch Reed in a ring against the Junkyard Dog. The same Hacksaw Butch Reed as he takes on another Hacksaw in the form of Jim Dugan. You'll see Kamala, the Ugandan warrior, versus Tommy Wildfire Rich. And talk about Rich, you'll see his cousin Johnny Rich join forces with Steve Dr. Death Williams in tag team action. And the man to tell you about it, our guest commentator, Cowboy Bill Watts.
Well, that's right, Boyd. And, of course, the North American Championship holds a lot of prestige and a lot of honor. And Hacksaw Butch Reed is that champion. And he said that the way that the match in the Superdome with he and the dog was presented, they didn't hear his side of it. And so he's asked for some time. So this is like the Hacksaw Butch Reed Hour to start with. I interviewed him earlier. First of all, he wanted to talk about a match with Hacksaw Dugan. He says he has beaten every top star in Mid-South and truly is on the pinnacle of success. Let's listen now to Hacksaw Butch Reed.
Ladies and gentlemen, the North American champion, Hacksaw Butch Reed. And Butch, you're king of the hill. You got the big iron, and it's all going to attract a crowd for you.
Well, you know, that's all part of being a champion. You know, I've done been through them all. What you have here in a champion is class. I've made this belt stand out and mean something. You got the soul brother number one. You got the man that's done paid the cost to be the boss. And you know, I've done whooped them all. I've done whooped Hacksaw Jim Dugan. I've done whooped the Junkyard Dog. That's the reason why I'm wearing this. And I recall a time back when I was very popular up on the wrestling charts when Jim Dugan claimed that he was the only Hacksaw in town, and I had to go out there and show him just who the true Hacksaw was. And I think you got a tape of that.
We got a film clip of March, the Battle of the Hacksaws, downtown New Orleans. And Butch, if you'll give us the commentary, let's watch that now. There they are. The people are in downtown New Orleans, Municipal Auditorium, a packed audience, overflow audience. And, of course, at this point, the people are all in your corner. They're cheering you, and they're not exactly.
One time they were on my side. And one time the people recognized class and recognized a prime athlete at the peak of his career. And now me and Jim Dugan here, we're getting ready to lock horns. He's ranting and raving, trying to psych me out just like he does in all of his matches, tries to make me think that he's so big and bad and tough and just can't be stopped. And we fixing to get it on right here.
Well, sparks are ready to fly with Hacksaw Dugan. And you've kind of compared Dugan and Dog together. Say both of them are first quarter men, that they have a tremendous burst of energy, but they don't have the endurance.
They don't have that fourth quarter endurance. Those boys was kind of lagging, you know, in the fourth quarter drills playing football. When I was up there at the top, I was up there in the lead, leading the pack. And now you see me jamming and whamming on Jim Dugan here. He flied out shooting everything he had at me. Right here, I've got him coming off them ropes sailing. Boom, right there, that big suit bone in that.
You have a lot of depth and a lot of scope in your wrestling ability. You can fight as well as use tremendous wrestling moves, your agility. We can't take it away from you. You've got the athletic ability.
Well, you know, I've come up hard. You know, nothing come easy to me. I know when I got to go out there, I got to fight for every little thing I get in any kind of way that I can get it with a man of this caliber.
Well, this was a long, grueling match. Again, these are edited highlights of that match March 21st in the downtown Municipal Auditorium of the Battle of the Hacksaws, in which you did win that match and the right to carry the title of Hacksaw Butch Reed.
Well, you know, Jim Dugan here, he's a tough man. You knock him down, he gets up, he's coming, he's staying right in your face all the time. And it takes a little bit of brains. It takes just a little bit more brains than I told the people that I have. I have more brains than the Junkyard Dog, more brains than Jim Dugan. And right now, Jim Dugan, he's lost. He don't know what's happening. He's all tied up in wrestling, which is something that he don't know nothing about.
Yeah, but he knows how to fight, and there he starts trying to chuck it to you again.
That's for sure. But I tell you what, you know, these soup bones here is hard to handle, Bill Watts. As you see, Jim Dugan right now is all dazed and don't know where he's at, and he's wrapped right back up into that arm bar. I'm trying to pull his arm out of socket right there. I'm trying to really put the pressure on him.
Well, certainly it seems like late in this grueling match that Dugan may be having a conditioning problem, and that certainly you seem to have hit your stride. You seem to be in that fourth quarter. But Dugan is a dangerous man. At any time, he can go with that heavyweight knockout, that home run punch.
That's true. You know, this man is known all over the country. He was a tough competitor. He was a tough football player, professional, just like myself.
Well, you caught him a shot there. You really tagged him.
That was a good roundhouse right there. And, you know, not too many people gets up from that. That's the reason why I admire this man.
Well, you're picking him up.
He will fight to the last. You got to really weigh him down. You got to really take him to the outer limits to keep this man down on the mat.
Now, he powers out. He's got a fighting heart. Dugan never gives up. Eric Dugan using a little bit of ability from the football field that he wasn't noted for, a little punting ability.
He tried to kick a field goal on my head here, and now he's on me like white on rice. And I mean, when this man gets on top of you here, you've got to figure out something pretty quick to turn the tide around, because he will eat you alive. Here, he's got me down from an elbow here. I managed to...
That's that powerlifting ability where you got that power.
That, yeah. Now here in the turnbuckle, this quickness right here. He thought he had me right there what does he call it? He calls that thing
spear.
A spear. And he's used that and hurt a lot of people. And he almost done it to me right here. Now I'm winding up on him. I'm giving him them double soup bones. And now he's up in
the here you body press that 285 pounds.
Right
that,
here.
That was tremendously impressive, and you slam him down hard.
Now Jim Dugan, he is really hurt right here. You know, not too many people gets up from that body slam there. And surely right here with that slingshot right there, that'll surely put the icing on the cake. Right there, the people are going crazy. I was a very popular man that night. I showed everybody who the true Hacksaw was. And now Jim Dugan is running around here ranting and raving.
Well, now you've got the title to prove it, but of course,
right,
Jim Dugan is a changed man also, and he's got the crowd behind him. And what difference does that momentum, does that enthusiasm add?
Let me tell you something, Bill Watts. I'm not trying to win no popularity contest. Like I told all you people before, all I'm doing is winning matches, and I don't care how I do it anymore. Junkyard Dog, you sold me down for that chump I just beat.
Well,
and I'm coming after
we'll
you,
be
bro.
Back right after these messages from Mid-South Wrestling Network. Saturday, July 16th in the New Orleans Superdome at Wrestling Extravaganza, your night of destiny, the night that you met for the showdown with the Junkyard Dog, the greatest wrestling athlete in the world today, a 2 out of 3 fall for the North American title, and you asked for the 2 out of 3 fall match.
That's right, because I told you people all along. I've been telling Mid-South, I've been telling New Orleans, Louisiana, Texas, all over everywhere. I've been telling you people that the dog couldn't cut it, that the dog did not have that thoroughbred endurance, that stamina to go the full distance all the way to the last minute in the fourth quarter. And I heard Mid-South version last week of how I'm such a controversial champion, how I won it. You got the tape here now, Bill Watson.
We got it.
Now I want to give you my version.
All right, let's roll that clip, the edited highlights of that 2 out of 3 fall North American title match in the Superdome.
Right here, look at him. Me and that rascal is thumping and bumping right here. He's got a punch that can put you to, that can send you to the promised land. I got to give it to him. He's a tough man, but he tries to wind it all up. He tries to wind it all up in the first 4 or 5 minutes. That's what I'm talking about when a man is don't have that drive to endure the full game plan, to carry it out to the fourth quarter, all the way down to the last minute, the last second. The dog is trying to put me away here.
Well, it seems like he wants to punish you so bad that you can't continue the other two falls, because he's out there to take your head off and to hurt you. A lot of animosity between you two.
That's true, you know. Right here, he has me on Dream Street. He's got a headbutt that's the most devastating maneuver in professional wrestling today. He's got the toughest headbutt in the sport. Right here, he's got me so dizzy, I don't even know what my name is. I'm just like melted cheese right here, Bill Watts. And he's just having himself a ball. He's howling to his people. His people are cheering him on. I'm down. I'm beat. I'm beat down.
Well, I was wondering right here why he didn't go ahead and finish you off and win the first fall and get the edge on you. Because if he had the first fall won, then all he had to do was win one more. He really had you behind the eight ball, but instead he seems to really want to punish you.
Right here, the man had me beat. He had me beat for the first fall, right here. But he's just resorting to all, any tactic that he can. The man is trying to hurt the Brick House. But the Brick House has that enduring stamina. He has that heart, that drive to keep on getting up and to keep on taking it and to dish it out when it's the right time for me to dish it out to him. Right here, he's on the ropes. He's dogging me real good right here. I'm bleeding. I'm a bloody mess right here. He's choking me. Now he's down on me street style. He's jamming my gourd something fierce. I don't even know what day it is. I don't even know where I'm at right here. You know, this man is uncontrollable. This man is out to do damage to me, my person, and to really try to put me out of professional wrestling.
All right, right here, he comes out and just intentionally feeds you to that iron post, which is an automatic disqualification. So right there, he lost the first fall. What do you think he's thinking about? What's his strategy?
That's his first mistake right there. His strategy right there is to put me out. Is to put me out and incapacitate me where I cannot continue the rest of the match, where I cannot continue to fall.
Did he underestimate your courage and your sticking power?
He sees me climbing up right there.
Right there is Mad Dog Sawyer. And Sawyer's calling for timeout here. And he's some time's elapsed. Again, these are edited highlights. And he's out there and he's brought some gauze, it looks like.
He's got gauze. He's trying to.
What was Sawyer doing out there?
I don't really know what Buzz Sawyer come down there for. You know, it wasn't really any of his business. But I guess that he sees the chance for a true champion to really shine and stand out. So he comes down and he wants to aid me in my goals for winning the North American Championship.
Well, this is in between the falls, and you're saying he's come down here to bandage you out of admiration for you.
I guess you could say that. You know, me and Buzz Sawyer has been upside each other's head before, and we got respect for each other. And I guess he wants to see me get an even shot.
You don't think it could be anything tuned to the jealousy of Mad Dog Buzz Sawyer trying to climb that ladder of success, because there's only one junkyard dog in the world, and Sawyer is trying to kind of hedge on and gain popularity off that name, and he's jealous of junkyard. Is that that couldn't have anything to do with it, could it?
Well, I wouldn't say that, because it's all kind of reasons why.
Second fall has started. Second fall has started. You're in the ring.
Right here. I'm all wrapped up with the gauze here. I'm bleeding like a stuck hog, but I still got that heart to fight back. I'm beat about half to death, but I still got that courage, and I'm still hanging in there with that
dog. But Buzz Sawyer hasn't left ringside.
He hasn't left, and I see that this man hasn't left, and I'm just wondering.
You're saying you have nothing to do with that?
I have nothing at all to do with that. I never called him down to the ring or anything. Right here, the dog is really trying, as you can see right here, he is using them headbutts beyond control. It's all unnecessary right here. This man is supposed to be in the North American champion then. And all he's showing is what kind of a real dog that he is. Instead of trying to beat me with the class of a wrestler, he's trying to beat me with the low down disgust of a street brawler.
Well, there's still a lot of intensity here. A lot of animalistic instincts are coming out between the two of you. It's just a brawl at this point.
Yeah, right here, he's got me beat down real well, Bill. Right here, I don't even know where I'm at. I know that Buzz Sawyer is still there. Yeah, I waved him in. I waved him in to get this dude off of me so I can get me some win. If that's what it takes, then that's what I'll do.
Well, the junkyard dog met Sawyer, knocked him out, and then he really caught you a form. But now Sawyer's come in.
I mean, he's getting riddled. He's getting drilled right here. That dog, he done went.
The referee is, of course, disqualifying you for the outside interference of Buzz Sawyer coming in, and the dog is winner of the second fall. So now it's one fall apiece, but Sawyer is not through with the war. He wants to fight some more. It seems like Sawyer's trying to make this his own personal challenge to the Junkyard Dog.
Right there, as you can see, I could see a little bit of...
So did the referee got taken out, which really opens the door. Here you're back in, and you and Dog are tooth and nail. This is in between the fall. The third fall has not started yet.
This is right in between right here. And the man is really trying. He's really trying to. Now here comes King Kong Bundy.
Now what's Bundy doing there? I'm sure that you didn't have anything to do with this either.
I didn't have anything to do with Bundy. You know, the dog is not a very popular man, you understand. You know, nobody wants to see the dog running around here, a falls champion, carrying a strap that he does not bring
right,
any
the third
kind of
fall has started.
To.
The third fall has started, but the referee is out of the ring. They have rang the bell for the third fall, and when the referee gets in the ring, this is what he sees right here. He's not come back into the ring yet, although they've rung the third the money fall.
He's out right here. But like I said, the dog did not have the lasting endurance to go the full distance. In the fourth quarter, when things got tough, who do you see on top right there?
Now, wait a minute. You're saying this is due to your endurance and the dog's lack of condition?
I'm still moving. Don't you see me?
You mean 420-pound Bundy and Buzz Sawyer had nothing to do with that conditioning?
What kind of beating did I take in there just a while ago? I must have been beat by about two or three.
Yeah, but I still think 300-pound
men right there.
Man to man between you and the Junkyard Dog.
Well, you know something, Bill.
There's the title. They're giving you the North American title. You're crowned the champion.
Right there. I'm Soul Brother number one. Right there. You see who the true champion is right there. I didn't have anything to do with any outside interference. As a matter of fact, I don't need any outside interference, and I'll defend this belt anytime, anywhere. And I want to get one thing perfectly straight with you people around here in Louisiana and all over. And you, Bill Watts, when y'all see me coming, you don't call me Hacksaw, you don't call me Butch, you call me Sir. And we're going to get this straight right now.
Ladies and gentlemen, we'll be back after these words from Mid-South Wrestling Network.
Well, you heard Butch Reed's side of it. And now another man who never seems at a loss for words or money or ways to get people to do his bidding, General Skandar Akbar, as he talks about his match that Kamala had against Tommy Wildfire Rich. Let's listen to that one now.
The Superdome, the granddaddy of them all, the most prestigious matches in all of professional wrestling. Tommy Rich from Atlanta fame has come to the Superdome to gain fame and fortune at the expense of the General and Kamala, the biggest mistake the Rich clan has ever made. And we'll show you in a film coming up just how we beat the snot-nosed Rich clan. Let's see this film now. Here comes Johnny Rich. He's entering the ring with no seconds license, no manager's license. But you know, Mid-South has a history of offering sanctuary, giving special privileges to certain individuals. And I'm sure Tommy Wildfire Rich has cried to the Mid-South officials to let his cousin sit at ringside. Very well. But you know, I don't believe that Tommy Rich knew in his demented mind just how awesome, just what a savage this man is. And all of my years as a wrestler and now the world's greatest manager, have I ever seen a man as awesome as Kamala? Why, even the mention of his name makes Andre the Giant shudder. Can you imagine that? Now here's Tommy Rich. Now he's trying to get away from the awesome Kamala. So ferocious, so tenacious. Look at Kamala. This man knows not when to back up. This man is a savage that dines on raw meat. And you know, I think Tommy Rich is going to be next on the menu right now. Tommy Rich. There was a bad mistake on the part of Kamala, but he knows not what mistakes are. He just keeps coming. Here we go again. These are edited highlights, I might add. Now Tommy Rich is down and in trouble. Can you imagine what's going through Rich's mind right now? He's saying, I wish I was back home in the Peach State. Tommy Rich down. You know, he was coddled by the local promotion. He stayed on top for years in Atlanta. But this is the Superdome, Rich. This is the granddaddy of them all and the most awesome man in all of wrestling. Yes, he just keeps coming. He doesn't know when to back up. He doesn't know who you are, Rich. He doesn't care who you are, Rich. A drop kick that would normally send a great heavyweight down to the mat. He just staggers the mighty Kamala. the Ugandan warrior, 400 pounds, almost 7 foot in height. Speaking of height, look at the reach on Kamala. Oh, that was a mistake, Rich. Oh, yes, I know you wish you were back in the Peach State right now. Relentless, the irrepressible Kamala, relentless. Look at the pounding Kamala gives him. Oh, yes, and Rich is fighting back. A little bit of guts, I got to give it to you, Rich, but just not enough. Once again, the referee is trying to restore order. I'm sure every referee that goes in the ring with Kamala has to be concerned because they don't know when this man's going to turn loose on anybody. And you can see right now, there is a little bit of a crimson flowing out of the head of Wildfire Tommy Rich of Atlanta fame. It's the Superdome, Rich, and you're down. You're down. There he goes once again, the irrepressible Kamala, a man that knows not when to quit, the most awesome of them all. Everybody hides from Kamala. I haven't heard from Andre the Giant in months because he doesn't want Kamala. But I know somebody that might get Kamala, and I'm talking about Hacksaw Doug. I'll get into that later. But right now, Tommy Rich, he doesn't know where he's at. All he knows is pound, pound, pound from a man that's 400 pounds. And we've even developed some kind of a heart claw for Kamala. Yes, a wrestling hold of all. Tommy Rich showing just a little bit of intestinal fortitude because right now he's fighting for his life, L-I-F-E, life. And there's the illustrious general. I always like to see the general. And Johnny Rich is chasing the general. He had no right to do that. We come into the ring at this point, and the referee does his job. He's stopping Johnny Rich. And, of course, I did my natural instincts right there, getting Tommy Rich to the mat. Now, this is what you get when you interfere in the general's business. This is what you get, Tommy Rich. And there goes Johnny Rich over the ropes, and Tommy Rich is in a lot of pain and trouble now. Where are all your fair-haired fans think of you now, Rich? You're down, you're beaten. As I said before, your face is a crimson red, and now Kamala loves it. This is what this man likes. He's thinking about that raw meat he dines on now, Rich. And yes, you're right there on the dinner table in the Superdome, fighting back, but what have you got, Rich? You're gone. You're a jealous. Hello, as you Americans say. You don't have it now, Rich. You're came to gain fame and fortune at our expense, and you're down. You're out. It's just a matter of time for this man. We've got things going our way. As you see, the general's got his chest puffed out. Rich fighting back with all he's got. He knows this is his life, not only his career, but his life. There you see the general in Friday. Oh, what a night this was. We beat the entire Rich clan, and we're clamoring for more people from Atlanta. Come on, all you talent from Atlanta, I want you to come to the Superdome and meet Kamala. Here comes the general into the squared circle. Oh, yes, I had to get just a little bit peace. And here comes that hippie. Just like all you hippies come out of those vacant houses when they're on fire, you can't. Right down to the ring. There's that greasy, slimy hippie. Had no business in the ring. As I told you before, I'm going to get you, that big bulbous bell pepper nose of yours, sticking my nose, sticking your nose in my business. I'm flabbergasted. I wasn't even in the match. Oh, yes, Duggan, that's another mistake you made. But you will never put your hands on me again, Duggan. Now, Duggan, since you insist on putting your nose in the general's business, I have a little bargain, a little deal for you. You're saying you always want to get the general in the ring. All right. I've got just a little deal for you. I'm hiring the most prestigious, the most powerful man in Mid-South right now, and that's Hacksaw Butch Reed, North American champion. And you saw him beat the dog, and he has a clear-cut victory over you, Duggan. Yes. And if you can beat Hacksaw Butch Reed, you can get 5 minutes with a general, but that won't be any picnic because I was North American champion at one time.
Well, General Skandar Akbar, let me tell you, when you get in that ring in Mid-South Wrestling, you're fair game. Whether you're manager, spectator, or wrestler, when you're inside that squared circle, you're bought and paid for, and I think everybody understands that, and Akbar just found it out that it's true again. We'll be back after these words from Mid-South.
Yeah. Well, Mr. Wrestling, too, you know wrestling fans all over the world love wrestling, and they watch a lot of different wrestling with the advent of satellite and cable TV and things like this. And I know the question they often ask is, where is the toughest wrestling? What's the highest caliber competition wrestling in the world? And I thought of nobody better to ask than a man who's an international star, a legend in his own time. You, Mr. Wrestling, too, could you answer that?
Oh, very easily, Bill. As you well know, I do travel all over the country from coast to coast, and without a doubt, it's right here in Mid-South.
How would you make that comparison? I know you brought a film clip for us.
Yes, I certainly did. Comparisons are very easy. You know, a picture is worth a thousand words, needless to say.
Let's roll the film clip you brought.
Let's see something here.
This is New Orleans, you and Wild Bill Irwin. Now, would you pick up the commentary?
Sure. Wild Bill Irwin, has he seen him whipping that thing there, snapping it around, showing everybody how well he can snap a whip. Snapping a whip is one thing, but can you get it done as a wrestler? You know, he went to Atlanta, he took that whip, and he took and wrapped it around Tommy Rich's back. Perhaps you might say he strapped him half to death. But perhaps he forgets the time that Mr. Wrestling, too, took that whip away from him and wrapped him up in it. You know, competition is where you find it, and right here in Mid-South is where competition is. Now, I've been everywhere. I've seen people here from coast to coast. I have wrestled more men than perhaps even yourself. And I'll tell you, Mr. Bill, watch. Bill Irwin, tough competitor. I'm not taking that away from the man. He's tough. He's good. But he's overconfident. He thinks that he has it made. He thinks he can overpower anything comes in his path. He's gone to Atlanta, and he's overpowered a few there. But he didn't overpower Mr. Wrestling, too. He tried his best. Why? Because here is where the competition is. Here is where you will find the finest wrestlers, the toughest wrestlers, the meanest, the obnoxious bunch I've ever seen in my entire life is right here in Mid-South. Let me tell you something, and that's hard to come by.
Well, Mr. Wrestling, too, I see here that you still go back to the basic wrestling maneuvers. You can mix fire with fire, but you still use the tremendous wrestling maneuvers to get you out of trouble, to dominate your opponent. Right there, that knee lift, that's the one thing at your trademark, the explosiveness you have in it.
Bill, watch, that's the tricks of the trade, you know that. You have to pull them all. You have to be wise, not only smart, but wise along with it. The man thinks he's got you. That's his fault. That's his downfall when he thinks he's got me.
Well, you're giving this man time to get back up. I think at this point you know that you've put a little fear in him. These are edited highlights, and Bill Irwin's face was kind of like, what am I doing in here with this mixmaster? He's just as tough as everybody told me he was.
It's strategy, Bill. That's what you have to use constantly. This man, once again, overconfident. He thought he had me. He thought he had things going his way. But suddenly, things turns around. You see, once again, he thinks he's got Mr. Wrestling, too. But what happened there? Here, yeah, he got me in the gut. I felt that. That stung me all the way down to my toes. But perhaps I misjudged. Not underestimated. I misjudged. And this man came on me and came with everything he had, Bill. Everything. He went to big extreme tactic to try and put me away, as you well can see.
He's hitting you with everything he's got, and he's taking it to you as good as he can. But there you are. You've got the confidence. You've been in trouble before, and you got the crowd behind you. And certainly that's an important factor, is when that crowd's behind you, too.
When you have that fire in your gut, there's nothing that's going to hold you down. When you have the determination to come to your feet, nothing's going to hold you down. Irwin is doing his best to try and sink me, try and cut my win off. He's doing everything he can to get rid of Mr. Wrestling, too.
Well, I think Bill Irwin found out that being a main eventer in Mid-South sports, that he wasn't ready for it. Although he's been a main eventer in many other areas, that you've proved with these film clips here that if you're a main eventer in Mid-South sports, you're the toughest wrestler in the world today.
Bill, you know very well, Mr. Wrestling, too, has been a main eventer everywhere he's gone. I've been on top everywhere, and I fight to the hilt. And this man here, he couldn't cut it here. Let me tell you, he couldn't cut it. He tried. He tried and tried many, many times, but he couldn't get it done.
It looks like you're getting him set up now for the coup de grace. You're really pounding him. We're going to stay until we see the finale right here with Bill Irwin.
Here it comes. Oh, here it comes. Look out.
Knee lift.
Lights out.
lights out for him. Another victory for Wrestling 2. We want to thank you for narrating this and answering our fans. We'll be back after these messages from Mid-South Wrestling Network.
It's tag team action now for one fall with a 10-minute time limit. In the red corner at 420 pounds from Atlantic City, New Jersey, King Kong Bundy. And his partner at 265 pounds from Russia, Boris Zhurkov. In the blue corner at 222 pounds from Knoxville, Tennessee, Tim Horner. And his partner at 275 pounds from Bandera, Texas, Bill Lafke.
Tag team action now. The rugged duo in the far corner of King Kong Bundy and Russian Boris Zhurkov against popular Tim Horner and his partner, burly Bill Rathke, who's on the outside of the ring. Is Zhurkov and Horner in the ring, and here's Bill Watts.
Well, another overflow crowd here at the Irish McNeil Boys Club for the television taping. We appreciate all the people that come out hot summer to enjoy the hotter Mid-South wrestling. Of course, you heard Skandar Akbar make some pretty great statements there, and if I know Grizzly Smith, he'll be quick to capitalize on them. Skandar Akbar said he'd hire Hacksaw Butch Reed, the North American champion, because he knows he can motivate him with money. And if he'll wrestle Hacksaw Dugan, and if Dugan can beat Butch Reed, that Skandar Akbar will get in the ring himself with Dugan. And of course, a week ago we heard Dugan say he wanted a chance to get Akbar on television. And I think Akbar's greed is getting right in there, and Dugan's wishes may be all the fans here at Mid-South will get to see that. I'd sure like to be here that day when Hacksaw Dugan would go against Reed, number one, with kind of the reversing situations where now the crowd and crowd support's behind Hacksaw Dugan, and Reed is the North American champion. And also then to get the opportunity, if he should win, to get Akbar alone in that ring for 5 minutes.
Bill, that would be something to behold as Tim Horner tags in his partner Bill Rathke, who's coming in for his first appearance against Boris Zhurkov, and in comes Bundy.
Oh, big Bundy. He's clubbing him. Rathke, as you can see, has got the weight, but it's not too well distributed there. Short of stature. Just doesn't have that aggressive heart. King Kong Bundy. King Kong Bundy met his match last week against Steve Doc the Death Williams. He met a big man that wouldn't back up. The Doc said the Oklahoma Stampede is here to stay. I guarantee you, whoa, wow, the avalanche there, Rathke. Five count.
Five count, Rick Pereira calls for the bell. That means Bundy and Zhurkov the victors in this tag team match. We'll come back with more action following this important message.
This event is for one fall with a 10-minute time limit. In the red corner at 251 pounds, the missing link. And in the blue corner at 240 pounds from San Antonio, Texas, Ken Johnson.
Ken Johnson in the red tights now as he sheds his jacket against the missing link. Johnny Martinez calls for the bell in the league after his opponent.
Oh, he just ran him across and introduced him to that ring post up tight. Missing link. He's got something missing. I don't exactly know what it is. See that he shows that ability. He shows the regimentation of training, and he shows that he has the skill level. But then he seems to just short circuit every now and then, kind of go into a world of his own. But he's a punishing, powerful man. Tremendous physique, not an ounce of extra weight on him. There he starts attacking that kidney. He chops that kidney. It's just methodical in its punishment of it. And the punishment that the man receives in a something like this is going to be ongoing for several days there. Ken Johnson trying to fire back. But his blows have little effect on the link as he just drives him down. He is really just snapmare. So there he again, he shows the wrestling skills and the wrestling technique. Methodically into those kidneys. I've not seen somebody be so methodical just to attack one point or one body position for a long time. Martinez asking the man if he's wanting to submit, but Link didn't even wait. Link let him go. seems to enjoy punishing them.
One thing he's proved, Bill, he knows a lot of wrestling holds, a lot of wrestling tactics. So wherever he's from, he's been wrestling before.
Gets him into that clutch situation.
Johnny Martinez raising the hand of the victor, the missing link. We'll have tag team action coming up following this word from Mid-South Wrestling.
It's tag team action now for one fall or remaining television time. In the red corner at 255 pounds from Memphis, Tennessee, Larry Hare. And his partner at 250 pounds, also from Memphis, Bill Rose. In the blue corner at 295 pounds from Lakewood, Colorado, Dr. Death, Steve Williams. And his partner at 238 pounds from Tennessee, Johnny Rich.
Tag team action, Larry Hare and Bill Rose from Memphis against Johnny Rich and Steve Dr. Death Williams. Bill, I predict right now that they will really form a formidable duo as Alfred Neely rings the bell.
Yeah, Doc and Johnny Rich are a good team. They're a good team. I think, to tell you the truth, that either one of them could beat both of these guys. Johnny Rich with finesse and quickness, and Doc with just brute force. There, Johnny shows he's got a little technique ability there, drives him right over to half Nelson. Hare gets his foot over the rope. Grizzly Smith has just handed me a note that next week, right here live on television, he is going to try to sign this match with Hacksaw Dugan and Hacksaw Butch Reed with the stipulation that if Dugan can beat Reed here on television, that he gets 5 minutes alone with Skandar Akbar right here on TV. This is unprecedented. I wish him luck. He's going to have some stiff negotiations, I'm sure, with Skandar Akbar, Reed, and Dugan. But I know Grizzly Smith can, when he puts his mind to it, he can be pretty persuasive. Headlock, tag is made. Bill Rose in. Johnny Rich quickly takes the other man over, takes him right over to the mat. Dr. Death right now is just getting to be a 295-pound cheerleader. But when the doc comes in, oh, it's Katie Bar the door. King Kong Bundy is still upset. He just met finally a big, tough guy that will stand right in there. Good drop kick by Johnny Rich. Caught him right up on the head, body slamming him. Doc is in. Johnny headlocking the man, not letting him get away. Doc pops him a couple of short ones. Doc throws him down like yesterday's wash. Doc throws that short, stiff one.
Another
right
thing
straight.
About Dr. Death, Steve Williams, Bill, when he comes in that ring, whether it's a single match or whether it's a tag partner.
Oh, look at his cross body block.
He comes in ready for action. He doesn't stalk or look. He just comes right on
in
going.
Well, that's the way he was in college, you know, when he'd wrestle guys in college. He just went after them. He wasn't pretty. Didn't have a lot of finesse. He just went out to beat somebody. He just understands one thing, that's winning. Backdrop. Larry Hare and Bill Rose have found out in short order that they don't belong in the Mid-South area. Gonna have to get in that gymnasium. They got the size, they got the frame, they're young. They're gonna have to go pay a price. There's no gain in professional athletics without pain. You've got to go train, you've got to get conditioned, you've got to learn your skills. Less than 1 minute of wrestling time remaining. Doc is just teeing off. A little bit unnecessary, I think, with these two guys, but Doc has got that mean streak. Johnny Rich firing away. There, Doc comes in and sets. Johnny Rich drop kicks one of the Hare and Rose. I think they better go back and get out the dictionary and look up wrestling and see what it stands for, because for some reason they're under a misconception as to their business in this sport.
And they are.
Dr. Death and Johnny Rich, a great young team.
Bill, it's time for us to go. Thank you, fans, for watching us. Remember, next week, Grizzly Smith trying to sign Dandar Akbar's challenge of Dugan against Hacksaw Butch Reed. And if Dugan wins, he gets 5 minutes in the ring here on television with Akbar. Till then, goodbye, everybody, from Mid-South Wrestling.